गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
या लेट अस स्टार्ट.
यस यस सर.
ओके सो आई वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर टुडेज ऑनलाइन वेबिनार on use of remote sensing GIS and GPS in mining and mapping, which is organized by Mining Engineers Association of India, Belgaum chapter, in association with Department of Geology, GSS College, Belagavi, and SG Balekundri Institute of Technology, Belagavi. A brief account of MEI, Mining Engineers Association of India. The headquarters is situated in Hyderabad. We have over 27 chapters situated all over India, almost covering all the states, east, west, north, south. Our Belgaum chapter started in 1984, and we are about 110 members, life members, which is headed by Chairman Sri S.R. Hegde, myself, Secretary Dr. P.T. Anamgod, Sri Sagar Wagmare as treasurer, and many others as council members. We organize regularly national seminars, workshops, and since 1984, we have also organized more than 12 national seminars, workshops. We conduct regular lectures, lecture meetings, and we meet, usually we used to meet monthly. And due to present day situation, that is pandemic, we could not meet since March. However, we have been organizing online lectures. I think this is the fourth lecture in the series, online lecture series. And I heartily welcome all of you once again for today's online seminar or invited lecture on use of remote sensing, GIS and GPS in mining and mapping, which is being given by Dr. Sainath Ahir, one of my friend from Sangamner College, Maharashtra. So I welcome once again, I welcome specially Dr. Sainath Ahir. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Before we start, we have lost one of our mining engineers friend, Shri Kamlesh Patel. We are very sorry to hear the loss. So on behalf of MEI and on behalf of all of you, we have a condolence today. Before that, just an introduction of Kamlesh Patel. Shri Kamlesh Patel was born on 3rd February 1974 in a well-known Patel's family, which is limestone mine owners. After taking chemical engineering degree from K.H. Patel's Engineering College at Hulkote in the year 1996-97, he had taken the charge of limestone mines from his father and developed it. He had an inbuilt affection about environment and social awareness. He has made his mine eco-friendly with greenery and participated Goa region under small manual mine group and had won first prize twice. He has also good communication and oratory skills. He had good coordination with all officials connected to mining industry. He became Joint Secretary for MSAK, Karnataka, Secretary Mine Owners Association, Bagalkot, Secretary ME and MC Council, Goa. Also, he was currently Joint Secretary of our Belgaum chapter. He was a good anchor and conducted as many programs as MOC, most of the functions organized by all these organizations, including ours. So on behalf of all of you and on behalf of MEI Belgaum chapter, we give a great condolence to our friend Kamlesh Patel. In this regard, I request all of you to stand for a minute. Thank you. So we pray Almighty to give or may his soul rest in peace. Next, we have today celebrating all over India, all the mining fraternities, Indian Mining Day celebration. We also pledge today, we all, please recite with me. We, the members of the Mining Engineers Association of India, salute our national flag and pledge to observe 1st November of every year as Indian Mining Day. Further, it will be our endeavor to uphold and follow with all sincerity, honesty, and integrity the best scientific methods and practices to prospect, produce, and preserve the mineral resources for the probity and prosperity of our nation. Thank you. Now I request our treasurer, Sri Sagar Vagmare, to introduce our today's guest speaker, Dr. Sainath Aher.
Yes, sir. It's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Sainath Parashuram Aher, a dynamic geographer with 11 years of experience in research, consultancy, and teaching with active collaboration with government as well as with a foreign research institute. His interest of research are sustainable water resources, disaster management using multidisciplinary ground inventory and geospatial technologies. He completed his PhD in the year June 2017 on the topic. He worked on the topic runoff diversion from western slopes of Western Ghats to Godavari Basin using geoinformatics. The project was the thesis was well appreciated by the government of Maharashtra, and for that he received the special honorary support from Maharashtra government for his PhD work. He has 11 years of experience at postgraduate department, postgraduate level in the Department of Geography from SN Arts College, DMG Commerce, DJM Commerce, and BNS Science College, Sangamnir. Presently, he is associated with the Sangamnir College as an assistant professor. He has received many awards and honors from the various organizations from India, as nationally and internationally. To name the few, he has received a travel grant from STEC School, Summer School on Sustainable Chemistry for Sustainable Development in this 2020 year from Leuphana University, Germany. He has received the Best Teacher Award from Sangamnir in 2020, Inspiration Award 2019 from Sangamnir College, Sangamnir. He has received BRF Excellence Award 2018 from International Benevolent Research Foundation, Kolkata, Best Paper Presentation Award from Shivaji University, Kolhapur, Geoscience 2016 Grant Travel Grant from Geosciences Editorial Office, Switzerland, Special Encouragement Award 2016 from Sangamnir College, Sangamnir, Special Honorary Support from Maharashtra Government for his PhD work, Avishkar State Level First Prize in Research Project Competition in teachers category, and the list goes on. So we have very delightful and experienced guest with us. He has traveled to countries China during the third international conference on water resource and environment in 2017 as a invited speaker, and he has visited Poland for ISPRS Summer School Technologies for natural environment management and monitoring in 2019. He has totally published papers, 43 papers and chapters, presented 30 papers, delivered 37 talks, and the list goes on and on. So it's my great pleasure to introduce to you all Dr. Sainath Parashuram Ahir for the today's webinar. I on my personal behalf, MEA behalf, and HGBIT behalf, I welcome you, sir, for the today's lecture, today's webinar. Thank you. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Sagar. So I request Sainath to take the session. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. Welcome.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So please screen sharing if you allow me. Please allow the screen sharing.
Yeah, one second.
Before that, we can say some words about this national level virtual seminar. I especially thank you to my respected teachers and my main respected sir, Dr. Pramod Anamgond sir, because I was met in his college, in JSS college, and that time I was surprised about his actually works. Also thanks to the Sagar sir, where we continuously meeting on the Facebook and observing so many kinds of activities there. And I also would like to really thank you for giving me an opportunity to presenting here. Okay. Yeah, am I audible and is my slide is visible to everyone?
Yeah, it is visible.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you to everyone for attending this interesting seminar, which is conducted on the occasion of Indian Mining Day. Basically, firstly, I would like to clear, I'm not a geologist, I'm not a mineist, or in fact, I'm not a related to the deeply knowledge of the geology. But I can talk about the remote sensing GIS, which is today is the main topic is here. And especially that, how this GIS, how this remote sensing and GPS technology is integrated or is linked with the mining industry and mine disciplines. So accordingly, I can talk yes with this in this seminar. So friends, as we know that this GIS, GPS, and RIS are integratively part of the geoinformatics. And in this geoinformatics, all the branches are included. Not only this GIS, GPS, remote sensing are included, but also like land information system, photogrammetry, geomatics, water resource information system, and presently mine information system also. Somewhere in the, and I even not seen in the India, but in abroad countries and many where the mine information system is also tried to integrate in, with the geoinformatics. So this is the one of the branch of science and technology which develop information. Basically, the purpose of this branch is developing the spatial information by collecting the different types of data, it's integrating in GIS software, and to visualize to the peoples who have easily access throughout this geoinformatics. It is the multidisciplinary fields. It's not related to specific geology, geography, specifically in another scientific branches. It is in all over in different branches, even in fact in the demography, in fact in the variety of discipline it goes to use. But the main purpose of this field is that basically acquiring, analyzing and visualizing data. Because we can collect the data, yes, and after collecting, we can integrate in the softwares and then start to some mapping, some processing as per our need, and then we can go to the visualized data. So of course the purpose of measurement, of course the purpose of mapping and presenting as it is the main task of this geoinformatics class. So just a short overview about this geoinformatics part. When we talk about the geoinformatics, basically the three branch are, multiple branches are included. But as per the seminar context and as per the seminar's topic, GIS, remote sensing and GPS are mostly need to discuss here in case of the mining planning, in case of the mining mapping, in case of the mining assessment and allied issues. So basically, GIS is a geographical information system. GIS is a geographical information system. RS is the remote sensing and GPS is global positioning system. Where in GIS, multiple types of data are integrated in a single layers. From multiple layers, we can integrate the data and we can use as it is conditions normally called in GIS language the real world. In case of the remote sensing, satellite is orbiting in the space and scanning our Earth surface and producing the satellite image, which we can literally use in the mining planning. And as we know that, I think GPS is a very common task in upcoming century, and nowadays everybody using GPS in mobile. So it's not so much, but for this, the various satellites is orbiting in the space and they are continuously connected with the whatever device we are going to use. And it's providing the one of the tool to us so we can map our ground, we can survey ground and we can do our related geospatial mapping. So geoinformatics and these branches is basically work with the different kinds of tasks and it can be integrated with the different types of mining applications. As you know that the mining is the extraction of the valuable minerals or other geological minerals from the earth, usually from an ore body, vein, reef or placer deposits. And these deposits form a mineralized package that is economic interest to the miner. As I just take from Wikipedia and just it's highlighting the situations of the what exactly the mining is and what is the mining. So this is the one of the aerial view of the open cast mining plant. Then is Eugene's areas. And how the geoinformatics is correlated with this mining industry. So the mineral exploration and extraction is a special task. As we know that it's a common task. It's clearly related with the ground surface. It's clearly related with the surface. Mining is, of course, carried out at the land and subsurface. So since most mines cover large areas with the diverse topography, land use, land cover, and other allied aspects, thus the task of mine management are perfectly suited for the GIS because it is a versatile tool for collecting, storing, and analyzing geographic information easily. So with these capabilities, we can use the GIS remote sensing and GPS. Specifically, we can just understand for basically remote sensing, know everybody. But what exactly the scientific remote sensing? Prior to go in details, we need to just overlook about this remote sensing. It just like this animated slide, it's just a scanning of a surface where this Landsat satellite of ESA is moving, orbiting in the space and scanning. This is the one of the scan. In second orbit, it's scanning this area and in third orbit, it's going to scan this third scan. So this just a scanning process of Earth. It's called as a remote sensing. But in this scanning, there is a no direct contact. It's called as a without physical contact or from a remote distance. That is why it's a remote sensing. Basically, it's divided into two branches: passive remote sensing, where the sun is the main source for the reflections, and here is another active remote sensing, which is specifically carrying the different types of weather and in the we can say that the night time. So this is the active remote sensing and passive remote sensing. The remote sensing is divided into two main branches. Then this remote sensing make use. How this remote sensing is carried out? With the help of electromagnetic radiation, which can be absorbed, transmitted or reflected by the object. And reflected radiation that is measured by sensor provide information about material properties, such as the chemical composition, surface roughness of the object, whatever objects, whatever land use land cover is associated with the earth surface, which can be scanned by the satellite sensor with the help of electromagnetic radiation. So electromagnetic radiations play very important role in case of the remote sensing. So short knowledge or the basic knowledge is really need in case of the understanding the remote sensing process and other mining and minerals disciplines. So as I just talk here, the types of remote sensing about the two types. One is that the passive remote sensing typically use the spectral ranging from the visible light and near infrared with a wavelength between 0.4 and 1 mu to the shortest infrared and thermal infrared up to wavelength of 10 mu. So all this wavelength and all this electromagnetic radiations playing very important role in case of remote sensing. And basically, we need to understand in case of the mining, scanning and mining remote sensing. So this is used, and this is one of the view of the spectral signatures of this specific wavelength. In case of the iron bands, in case of the carbonate bands, clay minerals band, and all these minerals having the different spectral response, having the different reflection, and that is why this wavelength and this spectral response need to understand very clearly. So minerals show various absorption features in both the visible light and near infrared and short wave infrared. Then again, thermal infrared that can be related to certain chemical components such as iron oxide and carbonate. So remote sensing, in the remote sensing and wavelength agenda, it's very mandatory to understand in case of understanding the deep knowledge of the mining remote sensing. So of course, a very short questions, and everybody can very familiar with these questions. What logic exactly behind the remote sensing, and why satellites see the mine from space? Because a more satellite is located in the 700 to 150,000 kilometer in the space, and it's capturing the mine at that highest resolution. Why? Because as we know that the incoming electromagnetic radiations from the sun, when it's interact with the earth surface, that time what is the object's materials, what is the object color which impacting on this? Suppose this is the one of the mine, gold mine in Turkey. That is why here is the high reflection as compared to the other region. So we can see here the other regions. Here is the vegetations, here is vegetations, here is some mining infrastructures. Because of this mine, because as we know that the gold is the reflective, and that is why here is a high reflectance. But in case of the coal mine, because it's a low reflection, because as we know that the black color is a more absorber and white color is a more reflector. So that is why with this logic, there is easy to detect the mine area and allied aspects from the this remote sensing. And For this remote sensing, the three main platforms are used: earthbound remote sensing, airborne remote sensing, and ground-based remote sensing. Nowadays, as we know that the drone, as we know the satellite, but some helicopters, some aerial televisions, which is mounted in the helicopters, and some aircraft is also used for the remote sensing process. And this is a application-based task for wide range of application in mining industry, not only in the one section, but we can say that during planning of the new mine sites, during mine operation after closure, because all the things means in the three stages we can use this entire data which we can obtain from the spaceborne, airborne, and ground-based remote sensing. We are just the one of the snap view of the how this data is produced from the platforms which I shown here. This is the aerial photograph which is collected by the aircraft. This is the drone photo of the mine area which is collected by drone. This is the 3D data, 3D perspective data of the some part of the Western Ghat, which is collected by the specific sensor which is mounted in the satellite, sometime in the some 3D techniques or sensor or perspective 3D perspective scanning. It's a normal satellite image. Sorry, it's a false color composite image collected by satellite. So all this database we can use in the process of the remote sensing. It's a very common questions and very basic things about the scanning process. The scanning process is not only happening from the space. Sometimes it's happening from the ground also. So most common method used for the exploration are airborne and ground-based geophysical method, which is geologists are more familiar with this, like a magnetic, electromagnetic, gravity, radiometric, and seismic investigation, basically to map the subsurface geology. So it's a one of the view of this. So where the pulses are reflected, pulses are emitted, and from this target, the reflected can be recorded. So normally called as a ground penetrating radar, it's a sensor which has a good potential for use in mine land detection. Compared to metal detectors, which has an EMI sensor, GPR can detect both metallic and non-metallic objects and has a capability of mining the target state. So this is the ground-based technology. But when we have to talking about the space-based remote sensing, then the multispectral and hyperspectral airborne and satellite provide valuable information about surface mineralogy and geology, which can be indicator for subsurface geology and presence of our bodies. So in this process, we have a good potential to map details about the mining in surrounding areas. From the airborne laser scanning, hyperspectral airborne terrestrial imagery, and multispectral imagery. Because as we know that mineral content can be quantified by comparing the data to no spectral feature of minerals and spectral mixing method, because it's not probably or possibly the surface of the earth is only covered by the mine. It's also covered by sometime dense vegetations, dense settlements, some other natural features, some man-made features. So unmixing is the one can be things where we need to properly detect. And there is a significant correlation between spectral features and concentration of various heavy metals. We can understand about it. So this satellite remote sensing is really a specific purpose of remote sensing. But one thing we must be noted that entire satellite, whatever satellite is moving in the space, orbiting in the space, all these satellites are not potential to mapping the mining. Like Landsat was developed by USA, which is a purpose of Earth resource monitoring, not the purpose of just monitoring the mining. But in another case of the India, ISRO's OceanSat 2 has a main purpose of ocean area monitoring, not the purpose of mining mapping. And of course, the questions in our mind are just a very basic questions. Exactly how many satellites in the space So I just tried to investigate the answer on not in the deep, but just on the Google. And in 2019, according to UN Office for Outer Space Affairs, there were 4,987 satellites in the space from the different countries, different sensor, different satellites. Does this all satellites are really useful for the mining application? No, the answer is no. And only few satellites which is, has a great potential, which data has a great potential, and which data is really capable to map the mining mining and associated applications. So like Aster satellite, which the data I can show here, the Landsat from USA with the data in the pulse color composite, Sentinel-2 data is like of this, and WorldView-3 data, for where they shown one of the mine here. So basically, recently two satellites, and this is the common satellite now, Aster Landsat, which is used for commonly for the geologic mapping. So we need to talk about this satellite in more different. Satellites give us the two types of data, true color image, false color image, where the original view of the Earth surface is tried to show in the true color sensor, but false color composite showing the different color, like this is the world's biggest dam in the world, Three Gorges, where the dense vegetation is shown here. And we can understand here why this Three Gorges having a biggest dispute or biggest controversy in the world. Because of this dense vegetation, this rehabilitation issue, this water body. But today's topic is not about the dam. So as per this view, we can share, we can also use such kind of data in the mining. Such kind of images are recorded by the optical remote sensing where the solar energy is mandatory. But sometime we have not possibility to, in Indian season and world season, to availability of the solar energy. So what we have to open, then we should be depend on the active remote sensing. And here is an example of synthetic aperture radar image, which can be captured in the all types of weather, in dense cloudy weather, in the heavy rainfall, and different types of weather. The synthetic aperture radar pulses can be, or radiations can be emitted or penetrate easily in any types of weather. So Earth surface is captured or recorded very clearly manner. So need to think about different types of available data for the mining. And once we talk about this remote sensing process, availability of the data set, which we can now literally use in the application process, but while go to this deep application or while applying this remote sensing data, we need to slightly understand about the what are the remotes, what are the image processing and AI software which is helped for this kind of data processing. Of course, a GIS is the framework for gathering, managing, and analyzing data, which I just talk here. And whatever GIS software are produced from the GIS technology, which is designed to store, retrieve, manage, display, and analyze all types of geographic and spatial data. So that is why GIS software produce maps and other graphic display of geographic information for analysis and presentations. This is one of the view where we can collect the different types of data with the different layers from the satellite data, some ground inventory, some GPS survey, and some other sources. And then we can integrate in a one single layer, and we can create the spatial model for the further planning. These types of integrations can support for the different types of analysis, where I just tried to detect one of the smoke in the area of the Ashoka coal mines, which is located in the Jharkhand state. And here is the with this slight image processing, no need to go deep, no need to go for the different types of a lot of fundings here. It is just a common task where we can extract the image or collect the image from the common available tools like a Google Earth, Google, and different types of sources. So this is the mine area. And what is this white patches? It's a smoke. I don't know exactly why it's created, but when the satellite is moving from this area, it's captured this smoke area. And we can understand what is the direction of this smoke area. So such kind of common application is very, as usual, very routine and very, what we can say, application based, which we can use in the research, educations, and different types of common applications. So like these are the applications while we integrating the remote sensing data in a GIS software. Like, as we know that the satellite is moving, orbiting in the space, and it is commonly capturing the whatever phenomena is active in the Earth surface. So here is the one of the view of the captured by NOAA satellite. Actually, NOAA is basically the weather satellites, but it's captured the California burns. And as we know that the burning issue in the, not only in the specifically California, which is in the Australia, which is in the different parts, tropical regions of the Earth, having a very common issue nowadays. And this satellite is very useful to monitoring this type of real event which is happening on the Earth. So I just stop here, the smoke issue. And here is the live monitoring of this fire or burns. So similar fact or similar incidents can be also mapped with the help of these types of live monitoring with the help of available satellites. So similarly, it can be detect the mining disaster also, which has a great potential. Now need to talk about when we have an availability of this lot of data, when we have the supportive environment, when we have this pre-assess of data, so how we can utilize in the common tools of GIS, common tools of geoinformatics, with the help of GIS software. Once we collect these types of data, we can go for the different types of mapping, because the today's seminar main theme is that the mapping of mining. And here I try to some mapping some bauxite mines in Western Ghats, especially the area of the Mandangad Ratnagiri, as we, most of the people are familiar with this area from the Karnataka, from Maharashtra and allied state. Because as we know that the mining issue become a more controversial issue in the Western Ghats. So just in the April 2011, just tried to map this area, which was the 124 acres in 2011. So here we can see this area. But exactly in 2005, the area of the same mine was just 447 acres. So from 2005 to 2011, how this area is going to increase, and here is showing with the same scale, both the image having the same scale, and when try to map this area, it's showing the this area of the this bauxite mine near Mandangad Ratnagiri area. So the area was here, but in another cases, where we can see this, and we can see here the how much area is goes to increase. So this is the temporal mapping, spatial mapping, which is very common nowadays to understanding about the changes, not only in the land use land cover, but also in the related features, related dimensions of the mine. So it's a very common issue, because by using this time series data and chain detection method, RS can be used to monitor an effect of increasing mine area and dehabitations. Because when the mine's area is goes to this, definitely there is the issue of the rehabilitations, definitely there is the issue of the environment, and definitely there is the issue of the forest and the other land issue. So definitely such kind of mapping we can carry out. Just with the curiosity, I just try to search, which is the largest man-made excavation and deepest open pit mine in the world. So I found this answer This is the Kennecott copper mine, which is located in the Utah. And just I tried to search over the Google Earth and found here, and just try to map the area of this mine, which is the world, as per the Google knowledge, not my own knowledge, because I'm not a geologist. But as per this Google knowledge, this is the copper mine area, which I tried to show with this digitizations, which we can carry easily with this available technology, like a Google Earth. Similar facts about when we talk about different types of spatial applications using this available tools and techniques of spatial technology, we can analyze or assess the different types of common issue with related to the mining area. So here is also one task was performed related to spatial mapping. Here is the Shawadi area in Kolhapur districts, where we can see in January 2003, the land was just a land. There was no mine, there was no any encroachment, there was no any activities from the mine-induced activity. But slightly in the 2060, we can see the mining was started here, and this is the area of the mining, which is shown here. In 2016, totally 27 acres area was undergone for the mining purpose. And this was one of the definitely area in the Western Ghat area near the Kolhapur, 27 acres. The similar trend is happening, and continuously mining goes to increase and need more land on some bauxites, and therefore in 2018, we can see that now it goes to expand here. The red line is shown the view of the how this mine area goes to expand. It's shown here. Means the, in 2060, the area was that. And now, in 2018, the area was that, which is shown here. But in 2000, continuous process happened, and in 2019, 68 acres area means this mining activity is continuously going on, and what we can say is spreading in allied area. And what is the trend of this mining means the logic is what? As per the common logic, we can say that there is a increasing trend toward the eastern directions. So we can see now we can see how this spatial mapping, how this temporal mapping, how this statistical analysis we can carry out this simple available tools which we can commonly call as the spatial mapping or temporal mapping, or we can say that not only we can carry only with this mining, we can carry in the multiple types of area, not only in India, we can carry from here. From this laboratory in multiple countries also. So it's it is possible because of availability of the open source data now today. As we know that the Chota Nagpur is the biggest reserve, and sir has already told me show some Google Earth application. So Google Earth now is providing multiple types of applications, and this is just a view. And we have a common questions and we have a common curiosity. Why these Chota Nagpur to be biggest reserve in the India? And we can say that as per the source, top five states in India with the largest coal mine reserves, which is closely associated in the eastern India, like Jharkhand, Odisha, Chhattisgarh, West Bengal, and Madhya Pradesh. So all this area compositely known as the Chota Nagpur Plateau, which is the biggest reserve. So we can understand also from the Google Earth, where is this common mines are located and where is this? This is not just more research. There is no need to do more research of, while understanding of this mining area. But we can just commonly monitor the whatever activities and whatever mines are associated here. As a part of this image processing and as a part of this image understanding, remote sensing understanding, It's one of the tasks of to understanding the visually, what exactly features, what exactly the forms, which is available at the remote sensing data. Because this is the common questions when we are understanding, while we are reporting these images, there is a common questions like some feature, does this really a road or drainage, like a soil or fallow land, does this really agriculture or mine, because we have a common questions while we interpreting this satellite image. So here is of course some questions. So we can see this feature, it's really making us a confusion. Does this a stream or road? And the answer is road. Why? Because preference, because the shape of this, and because the association with this mining. Here is a mine area, and of course, from the mining, there is no possibility of the drainage maybe start to flow. So commonly the great correlations we can confirm here, it's the road. It's definitely a road. Why? Because it's a mining, and for any mining we need a road. And for this road, for this mine, the road is connected. So great association with this roads, feature understanding and mine area. Then some fallow land based on the reflections, some forest area, some gullies, valley, road, and streams. This is the streams where we can see the streams. So visual interpretations is a common technique and which is great potential to while understanding the mines area. And with this, all the strips of infrastructures, natural infrastructures, this Shahwadi Kolhapur bauxite mine is located. So means when for the educational purpose, research purpose, we are understanding about the mine. So allied environment, we can easily notice by these visual interpretation techniques for the purpose of land mapping. But it is possible and there is a maybe a possibility while interpreting some feature, there may be some mistakes. Like, does this really a streams? Does this really a gully? Or does this really hills? It may be some confusions. So better way, if you have a local, then we have good chances to understanding the things. Like, I'm from Sangamnir area. So I just try to delineate some real things on this Landsat 7 satellite image. So here we can see the city. Here we can see the Provara River, some national highway, which is very difficult to notice from the available satellite data. And of course, from Landsat, it's very difficult. But as I know from local with this, so I know the ground reality and I can delineate here. Agriculture area is most commonly shown by the red colors at the FCC image, false composite image. And water body, why? Because it's a great absorber and that is why it's a black features is there. So all this kind of situations, all this kind of land use, land cover, we can commonly, no need to go deep processing. Just with the common downloading, we can understand about the whatever situations existed at the surface. As we know, the mining, because furtherly, we need to talk about the net zero mining. It's a very common issue and someone also told about it. So mapping of mine area, need to consider the environment in great perspective, because where the mining is already carried, what is the exact impact in the environment? What is the exact impact in the allied socio-economic infrastructures like agricultures, like forests, like water bodies, and allied situations? So the reflection logic, which we just discussed here, which I had discussed here about the electromagnetic radiations and its reflections. So in this overall view, this is the sharp reflection in the white patches. It's a mine area. But here we can see the Srivardhan near the mine area, Srivardhan, near the Srivardhan. So this is the dense vegetation area. And in this, all this dense vegetation, the one of the white patches, and this is the mine area. And now we can get the answer why Western Ghat and its mining become a more controversial issue. Nowadays, when mining is leading, mining is expanding, that time definitely encroaching to the dense vegetation, and now vegetations and allied things can be reduced. So it's, and not only vegetation is reduced, it's a great threat to the very sensitive species which is located in the forest area, which is located in the Western Ghats. So just for this purpose, we can go in details for the environmental assessment related to the Western Ghats, because as we know that the Western Ghats is the one of the hotspot biodiversity in the world, and we need to think about this common application for this such kind of applications. As a common tools which is available in the GIS technology, GIS software, like a buffer. Buffer is what? Buffer is that the area around the specific features, area around the point, area around the polygon, area around the line. So here is one of the mine in the Odisha area where I tried to demarcate the buffers. Not only in this, at the Google's area, in the circle form, the buffer we can also form. And when it's buffer or plot or buffer we can enter, buffer we can delineate there. So we can easily understand with this increasing buffer, how much area goes to increase in this specific buffer or circular buffer. And we have also feasibility to commonly with this existing mine, we can plot a buffer, because buffer is very important to distinguish some further management from the administrations, because sometimes government is exactly delineating or plotting the buffers. Activity should be strictly prohibited, or activities should be strictly controlled in this buffer area. So supposed to be here is the sub buffers, and rules regulation can be made accordingly. So we can say that such kind of tools, buffer analysis and all this spatial analysis, is a great potential in administrative decision making, and a great potential in the further assessment. So like a common, commonly we can go for the mapping and analysis of the buffer in this. These all the things, both the 3D remote sensing and integrations. Nowadays again the 3D data, it has a great integrations, and this types of 3D data has been integrated in the remote sensing from the remote sensing, and which is a vast application in the mining arena. So photogrammetry, where we can collect the 3D perspective of the earth surface and different types of mine area. Another issue is that the lidar, this is one of the lidar which was also collected from my one of the friends, which is located in Poland. And this is the lidar which has a great resolution up to 1 meter. So this is because of the laser scanning, lidar light imaging detection and ranging. And similar, the terrestrial mapping TLS and ALS, which we can produce, and laterally then we can use in the mining sector. Such kind of images from the spot satellite and different types of satellite, we can extract and then go for the further analysis. Here is one of the, not my work, but I tried to show mapping of my tellings in World View 3. So there is some west is flowing toward that sea area in the city area from this mining area. So the common environmental assessment is become very easier with using this existing database. And this is the original photographs. So we can see this something west, and as we know that west is not a west, sometimes it may be a toxic. So such kind of toxic materials or west material, in what direction it's going to flow, we can easily map with this existing data. And now everywhere, as we know, the digital technology, so digital topography is one of the source for allied applications and allied assessment of the mining and other sectors. Because this is the one of the view which I will produce for one of the villages. And here is slope view for the Upper Godavari basin, which I produced. Not a specific purpose, we cannot talk about the specific purpose, because here is which I it was existed with me, so I use here try to show the slop situations of the Western Ghat, which is close to Mumbai and Thane and some Gujarat part. So here we can accurately map the slope with the advanced digital elevation model, and here accurately prepare the digital topography. And as we know that the, what are the applications in mining sector, because the written knowledge of the surface topography is important in several aspects of the mining industry, and that is why 3D data can be support. Slope geometry can provide information about changes in erosion and sedimentation process and soil properties, because as we know that the erosion, sedimentation and soil things is also closely associated with the mining, and that is why this can be, this chain detection can be used. And allied geomorphology, because geomorphology determining something close relatively with the mining, and that is why geomorphology, 3D models, all this can be with the integration of hydrological feature also, means geomorphology, hydrology, and all this 3D perspective view integratedly can be used for the mining assessment. So it has a great potentials, and like this was, we can create the vast model of the different area. I have created in 2018 this types of model for the Sangam Rasitya, entire Sangam Rasitya, where commonly we can assess, where commonly we can retrieve the information about what exactly the situation of this tehsil. I'm showing whatever available with me, and as per this, if I create this for the one of the tehsil, definitely we can create for some mining area like Chota Nagpur and different locations, and then we can go for the further analysis like where is the mine locations, where is the environmental conditions, where is the river, like this is the Prawara catchment, this is the Nuwa catchment, where is the topest point of this of this area, where is the deepest point, and where is the what exactly the geomorphological situation and what exactly the hydrological situation. So with this knowledge, we can integrate in and we can go for as per our requirement, as per our demand, and as per our planning, we can analyze this kind of 3D perspective views. And I just talk here, the integration of geomorphological and hydrological aspects in case of the mining sectors. So here is one of the view of the Western Ghats of the Konkan region and Arabian Sea, where we try to map the mining. This is my one of the friends. This is not my personal work. This is my one of the friends' work and his work on this topic for PhD. But I would like to say this maps I personally prepared in the GIS technology. So I can show here. So here we try to assess the whatever river network associated in the Konkan region, whatever river network associated in the Western Ghat. Here is the east flowing river, here is the west flowing river. This is the Western Ghat area, and the blue things we can confirm here as the water body. This is the Koyna dams and allied dams. Koyna dams and allied dams series is here. But in this, as we know, the what is the Western Ghat? It's a very vast area. Even we can cover only one spot in a single day, and surveying is very difficult in this Western Ghat. But using this remote sensing data, using this 2D satellite data, using this 3D digital elevation model, and its integration in GIS software, and using some SOC modeling, we can create such kind of high accurate digital map, which has no challenge as compared as like of conventional surveying in that. I'm talking about the Western Ghat. So here in this Western Ghat, try to map some mining area. And here is a zoom view of this, where we can see the some continuous mining in the lower basin of the Savitri River. Savitri River is flowing toward that direction and flux in the Arabian Sea. And in this area, we can see the mining concentrations. There is only one mine in the Amba Basin, but in Savitri Basin, especially the lower basin, there is multiple types of mining, bauxite mining, and not only the mining of a single mine, it's a continuous series. And nowadays, why this mining issue become a threat? Because what is the net zero mining? It's an upcoming issue, and lastly, we'll talk about it. But it's about remote sensing data, GIS, and the things which is associated with the tools and things associated with the GIS, remote sensing, and GPS, which can combine integrate in this spatial mapping, and we can represent, visualize, modeled the mining sectors. Showing this Savitri Basin and Amba Basin. So here I show some mining activities in the Hiranyakeshi Basin. So this is one of the Jangam Hathi, and this is the mining area, and some buffers is created here because it's a very small space compared to this scale, and that is why I try to show here. But in close proximity, we can understand where is a stream, where is a dam, and where is administrative boundary. Now, again, some for decision making, there is some decision making process, and for this decision making, we need to know about what exactly the administrative boundary is playing the role. And with this curious things, when I was delineating this mine area, that time I found which is exactly located on the two tehsils of, I'm not sure, but I'm, with these two administrative boundaries. So this may be a sensitive subject. This may be a lengthen for the administrative decision maker. This may be one of the barrier for taking a decision-making process very rapidly. So all this kind of spatial mapping, all this kind of spatial modeling, we can perform with the integrations with the remote sensing GIS, remote sensing and GIS. Now this remote sensing is also useful for the such kind of remote sensing water mine, because we can extract almost most of the surface hydrological factors with the help of remote sensing data. This is, you can see here the streams, the primary, first order stream, second order stream, third order stream, and then some of the reservoirs and some 3D perspective views from the remote sensing data. So we can correlate remote sensing water and mine. Then the remote sensing data integration in image processing software, as we know that, and I think everybody are familiar with this, land use land cover has a great potential while taking the decision in mining sector. While before planning, before and after this mining activity, so this is one of the land use land cover map which I was created in Bandar Dharadam, which is located in the Western Ghat, Ahmednagar district. So we can see here the dense vegetation. We can see here the some hollow land. We can see the water body, rivers, some administrative boundary in some villages. Because whatever activity we are developing, whatever things we are carrying around this mining area, that time as we know that the villages point and villages area is also playing very important role, because as I heard about the Malaygiri dispute about the some development in Odisha state. So the some gram panchayat, local gram panchayat was became aggressive and stopped the entire development in this area. So understanding this administrative background, understanding this demographic aspect, socio-economic aspect, and understanding of the natural factors, natural land use land cover, road, all this infrastructure is very essential while making the planning, while processing mining, and after the rehabilitation on chloro mining. So overall environmental impact assessment, we can perform with the help of this existing available remote sensing data with the help of image processing software. So it has a great potential. Not only the land use land core, we can also detect the contaminations. And here is one of the photographs of the some environmental damage to the mine from the Norway. And here is some trailings or what we can say the copper mines. And here is some incidents. Thus, after talking of this remote sensing, there is some tools and techniques like some thermal camera which we can use at a ground, and this thermal camera, near infrared camera, and can be used for the different types of applications. Okay, thank you. Yeah, so how we can use, because as we know that upwelling groundwater and surface groundwater is a different temperature. And with this logic, we can map where is upwelling water and where is the surface water in this case. And such kind of thermal infrared camera, which is helpful for detection of leakage from mine tailings ponds. At a certain times of the year, there is a likely a temperature differences between contaminated water leakage from tailing ponds. And so here is one of the example of this, because as we know that whatever contaminated water has a different temperature and whatever regular water has a different temperature, and because of this variation in temperature, with this thermal camera we can easily map where is the contaminated water and where is our general water. So here is a drone based analysis. This is the common drone based images. This is both the images are collected with the help of drone. This is the normal photographs, but when we collect the same area with the thermal infrared cameras, that time we can see the color differentiate. And here is a show the high temperatures, and this temperature, just a minute, yeah. This temperature difference in thermal infrared images show possible groundwater upwelling as indicated by colder temperature, because as we know that the whatever water is upwelling from the ground, it has a cold as compared to the surface groundwater body, which has a different temperature. So such kind of analysis we can perform using available existing technologies. But after talking of this remote sensing technology, some mapping, some barriers or some challenges is also need to understand about this remote sensing, like the challenges of the major challenges for using optical remote sensing. We have some challenges in using optical remote sensing. Like this is a common photographs of leaching, and this is more common in the Arctic regions, because as we know that with this changing weather, it goes to concentrate on the whatever object is there, and that time its scanning and different types of spectral response creating the more confusion while processing the image, while interpreting image. And that is why this common issue need to understand, or we can overcome this issue while after using the good database. So such kind of leachings and some like vegetation mixtures are responsible for different types of reflections, because as we know that whatever tree shape is there, the tree shapes is not allowed to completely proper reflections, especially in the shadow region of this tree, and that is why some common issue can arise. And that time we need to think advancedly, or we need to think with the advanced remote sensing. And in this advanced remote sensing, we have a great option nowadays. We have a common option, we have a common source, we have common options like a synthetic aperture radar, like a laser scanning, which can easily penetrate from the any types of the different weather, like cloudy weather, like a smoky weather, and like in rainy seasons, like in the night. So in all seasons and day and night, we can scan our surface. So nowadays, this advanced remote sensing is greatly support for the advanced level of mapping. And like we can think about the synthetic aperture radar, which has a great potential. Synthetic aperture radar, which has a great potential to map the Earth surface without any barriers of clouds, rainfall, and like some night view. So we can, in all weather and night, we can collect such kind of data with the help of this synthetic aperture radar. And why this synthetic aperture radar is a real great potential in or this types of data and applying in the in common applications, in a surface application. As we know, the open pits stability issue is a very main issue. And as a usual, due to steep slope, often required by the extraction techniques and the geometry of the ore body, satellite INSAR, means synthetic aperture radar, can provide information about the distribution, amplitude, and evaluation of ground deformation or open pits mine with the help of this synthetic aperture radar. And advanced remote sensing in GIS can create maps like this. And this is one of the temporal visualization at the specific space of this mine. How we can create this with the very easy access of data, where we need to obtain the data, where we need to integrate in GIS software with the different types of, and where we need to use different types of tools and techniques for digitization, for superimposing, for overlay analysis. And finally, we can come to the analysis and visualization. What changes, what real fact is happening with this mine? And it is possible because of this integration of the remote sensing and GIS. And this kind of mining and these types of mining is not just related with this kind of application, but also nowadays just moving toward the web-based applications. And here is one of the mineral titles online is the first e-commerce GIS web-enabled system for mineral title acquisition in British Columbia. So everybody can access this website and see whatever things they have created here. So this is for the mining. This is for the mining application. What the application? The use of the remote sensing data, use of the GIS, use of the web-based platform, and integration of such kind of the vast information with the different types of layer, having great potential for applying these significant tools and techniques. And that is why miners or why mining companies prefer the GIS, because it has a great potential in target mineral exploration, evaluate mining conditions, modern mine constructions, display geochemical and hydrological data, and all these kind of applications. I think time is gone, so I need to cover these sessions. Apply for mining permits and all these things. So with these things, with this potentials, mining for the GIS, not only GIS, mining company also prefer the remote sensing data, mining company also prefer the GPS technology. So just slightly we can understand what exactly the role of GIS software in a mining companies, which is a great geographic advantages to target mineral potential, which is a great applications in mineral exploration. Geoscientists use diverse types of data set to search for the deposits. They need to view and analyze this information quickly and easily, because as we know, for the further decision making, we need to quickly assess of data. So here is a great solutions. So as we, as a common S3 Environmental System Research Institute prepared or developed most of the softwares to to bring the data together in easy to use software application and tools, increasing the spatial context of information available to mining planners and giving them more true understanding of the geography and prospective sites. This is the commonly used. But when we are talking with the remote sensing and its integration in GIS and various types of applications of this GIS software, now how GIS can be integrated in these types of existing technology? And this GPS is common, and nowadays I'll show you commonly used in every sectors, and how it's going to use in the mining sector is also need to think, because this is a powerful serving tool. It can provide on its own or in combination with other ground server techniques. Okay, just a slide. With the other ground survey techniques, they require speed, accuracy, and economy in surveying in large mining, because no need to spend much or more money, no need to go in the deep end, no need to buy a satellite. You just need to buy a GPS, and with the GPS, we can integrate in the different types of applications. Like nowadays, the DGPS, which is also a differential global position system, which is a very vast application. And that is why, as compared to the conventional coal mining survey, positioning and monitoring approaches are both time consuming and costly. And that is why, with this existing technology of GPS, we can use in case of the various types of spatial planning concerned with the mining industry. And as we know that the India has developed the GNSS, Global Navigation Satellite System, Regional Navigation System, GNSS, Global Navigation Satellite System, like India has developed Regional Navigation System. And these types of navigation system increase the productive availability of the ultra-heavy mining trucks, giant excavator and earth mover that extract the transport minerals or from open-cut mines to processing facilities in some of the most remote regions of the planet. So from excavating this material, transporting to the park, we can continuously monitor this lively situation, because GPS will be definitely play an important role in maximizing profit of the mining industry in the immediate future. So just a common view. What are the application in coal industry? It has in a mining industry, as a fast and cost-effective instrument. This is a cost-effective and fast. It's providing the real-time GPS information. It's providing the real-time surface information. And that is why it goes to use in a nowadays. Advanced GPS system also track and monitor the status of location of dump trucks, because all these infrastructures are continuously used in the mining sectors, which providing the reports to their heading and velocity very fast. Similarly, live GPS is becoming routine for monitoring and dispatching trucks or drills and providing great control on this sectors. Serving is a more common issue, because as we know that while we are handling some serving techniques at a ground using theodolite, using dumpy labor, using electronic theodolite, so there is some barriers like intervisibility and require some multiple types of human resources. But GPS measurement do not require intervisibility between points, whereas the conventional surveying tools require line of sight. In case of the surveying, for the common instrument, conventional instrument like electronic theodolite, like the dumpy levels and like some other platforms, need an intervisibility, but GPS not required, because GPS directly connected to the satellite space. GPS is directly connected to the satellite, GPS satellite in the space, and that is why it's providing the good signal, and it can be used for the different types of surveying. It offers many advantages compared to the conventional survey method, because there is no need to for a road person, e-survey can work alone when necessary. A single man can be do survey very easy. We have made multiple types of survey in our regions, and I think it's a good option instead of the other way, and very easy to carry. And that is why GPS has a great potential in the mining industry. And GPS also require much less setup time than the traditional surveying equipment. So we can just view here applications and what potential here. In case of the Indian mining, especially that the coal mining, India coal production is expected to double at 600 million tons in the next decade. And to realize this impressive growth, optimum utilization of the modern technologies like GIS and GPS in all aspects of mineral exploration are essential. The government is urging the industry to make effort for increasing use of GPS technology for locating new mineral resources and implement scientific planning for exploration of natural resources for better management. And GPS is being used extensively in the bench height control, drill elevations, topographic survey, and geological mapping in Indian coal mines. So great features for the GPS and all these situations. So likewise this, just a minute, some waiting. Okay. GPS in mining industry having various applications. I'm not going into details, but we can see just every vehicle control, not only for the kerosene tanker, not only for the, our mobile is one of the, we can say, is controller. So, because where we are moving with this, enabling GPS, so it's tracking ourselves or recording our track. So like same here, we can suppose the loading of trucks with the help of this excavator, then it transport where it is going, then unloading, if it is unload or not, and then again return transport, and then again come to back. Entire situation with the real time tracking, with this real time and with this generating the accurate path, GPS is monitoring each and every thing. So having a great potential, and such kind of tools and tools of GPS is used in the TISCO for truck dispatching system. What system is developed? Truck dispatching system have been introduced recently in the projects of Bokaro projects, which is located and northern coal fields. Based on their performance, it performing success, and that is why based on this performance, the same is being replicated in the other big coals mine in India. And now this technology is actively running in the most of the coal mines. GPS application must be viewed as a beneficial to the coal company and in turn the coal mines themselves. It found benefits because economic benefits also mentioned, and regular information benefits also important, and that is why they are using. When we using at a real time GPS, so we can see how, because we have carried one of the recently survey in the Ahmednagar districts. This is a plateau area. There is a different solar projects purpose. And this land, the one of the company want to use for the solar purpose, and that is why we had GPS survey in this area. So we can see the, this is the road, and this is not digitized. This is not created with this with the help of paint software. It is created by, or it is generated by this GPS, and laterally we have just incorporated in the GIS software, and then again open on the existing satellite image, and then this is the whatever survey was carried out, and just not a, and it is not just a line, it has a great attribute data which is need for analyzing, so we can perform the GPS rail survey at ground. After overall of this topic, after discussing of this remote sensing, GIS and GPS, now need to think out what is the net zero mining. But as I already told, or I had already discussed here, I'm not a geologist. I'm not a, basically the specifically the my area is not related to mining. But whatever I tried to search, where I found that net zero refer to achieving an overall balance between emission produced and emission taken out of the atmosphere. So again, I think this issue is closely related to the environment, and whatever emissions, whatever carbon emissions produce, it need to reduce the in the upcoming century, upcoming days. And because we seeing whatever encroachment, whatever environmental disturbance happening from human, the nature is showing time to time its reflectance. And just we are seeing COVID-19. So in case of this net zero mining, so this is one of the global mining companies target greenhouse gas reductions in billion, all of billion. So we can see here, mining, which is clearly related to the earth surface, and that is why this mining and environment need to think on priority in the upcoming time. Otherwise, very sensitive issue, which is associated with human life may be happen in future. Because one of the time in March 13, 2019, I was read this article very carefully related to mine, coal mine. And as we know, this person, Dr. Madhav Varki, this very famous environmentalist working for the Western Ghat area, especially the Western Ghat Ecological Expert Panel, and submitted different report to the government and highlighting the alarming situation in Western Ghat. And if you not control, if you not prohibit the human encroachment in the Western Ghat, then what will be happen in your future is also highlighted in different types of report. Because I personally read this report so many times, a report of the Western Ghat Ecological Expert Panel's report, which is submitted to the government. But government was not initially agree with this report, and laterly the Kasturi Rangan and all this people's panel was also established and tried to preparing another reports. So this is not issue of this is the issue of debate. But I just want to summarize here. When we're talking about this emissions carbon issue, this coal is also the one of the issue, because coal burning creating some carbons, creating some emissions, and that is why how we can reduce. But in this article, they clearly highlighted in Marathi, you can see कोळशाची गरज आता कुणालाच राहिली नाही. Why? Because we are adopting the advanced technology. Yesterday, my one of the friends buy the car, and what was the car? Car is electric. And just we made a calculation on the paper, and we found electric car is a very real potential. No need extra fuel. It's going 300 kilometers in one charging. So automatically, people are converting toward the sources which has a naturally available. We have a great potential of solar energy. This earth resources, human, environment, main agenda of the global agenda. This is not agenda of myself. This is not agenda of you all. This is the agenda of the global. And what global is exactly want? Global wants sustainable development. And that is why this sustainable development can be led with the help of this advanced technology. And that is why I can conclude here. Why this remote sensing, why the GPS, and why this remote sensing and allied tools and technology is useful in mining? Because GIS software is ideally suited to assist mining professional in meeting the complex challenges of running the mine operation. With tools to compile, process, display, analyze, and achieve massive volume of data. Because data handling, one of the tasks, and which is simply maintaining from the JS software. From discovery to production to mine closure and reclamation, remote sensing JS and GPS software solutions are increasingly being applied to the business of mining. Because all these tools and techniques, because I had already told, we cannot go in the dense vegetation area, but we can perform survey, we can analyze this area with the help of this advanced informatics and advanced existing technology, and that is why this has a great potential. GPS data can also be tied to GIS to monitor the location of all equipment in real time. And because of this great potential, because of this greatest, the greatest applications, we can use this technology for the real sustainable development. And that is why mining companies use remote sensing data, GIS and GPS data to actively monitor the environmental impact that may be caused by their activity. Because finally, whatever human are doing, its environmental impact assessment is become a new arena issue, and that we need to focus here. And that is why it has a great potential. So as a conclusion, I can see here, because environment, we need to one side a development and we need to maintain environment in another side. We cannot destroy our environment. And if we destroy our environment, if we try to overcome over the nature, then what will be happen in upcoming century? We can see, we have already seen in different types of incidents which is happening. And maybe this may be a luck. And that's why I'm delivering these lectures via online platform. Because if there were no COVID, if there is no COVID, then maybe a chance to visit the JSS college. But because of this COVID-19 and all this situation, because man is trying somewhere to overcome the nature, and that is why some problems happen. In case of the today's session and in case of the today's theme, National Mining Days, we need to think how this GIS is really useful to make a sustainable mining. And that is why I think GIS is ideal for integrating various exploration data sets, such as the remote sensing data, geophysical data, GPS survey, geological maps, radiometric survey, and mineral deposits. All this data can easily integrate in a one tools of GIS, and then we can go for further assessment related to environment, further assessment related to the surface, and further applications. So this GIS supports entire mining cycle, whatever mining, just we have to see. And maybe here, link with this here lectures or not link with this lectures. But GIS supports entire mining cycles, from identifying target site for drilling, mine planning and development through the reclamation. GIS technology is for 2D and 3D visualization, prospectively analyze land management, process management, financial and environmental reporting for better sustainable development. Finally, we returning to that point again, because final aim is that environment and development. Develop to ourselves, develop to infrastructure with the help of environment. And that is why this environmental consideration is really a need of time. As for the upcoming centuries, because one side we want to development and one side we want to protect our environment, and that is why for this green world we require such kind of GIS, GPS and all this kind of technology. I hope my time limit is crossing, so I try to conclude here. And I'm again saying, I just try to show how this GIS, remote sensing, GPS technology is really useful to go with the mining development with the consideration of the environment. So, I especially thank you to my respected sir, Dr. Pramod Anamgon sir, and all the coordinating teams who have given me this opportunity to present in front of all these the scientists, expert teachers, geologists. So thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sainath. Please close the share.
Yeah, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
So
it was excellent talk. I hope all students and other members have appreciated it. Let us open your talk for discussion. Anybody has any questions or queries, please unmute yourself and you can ask directly.
I welcome to all questions.
Any queries, any questions, queries,
any suggestions?
Yeah,
no problem.
And from December we will be starting a certificate course of 30 hours in our department, application of remote sensing and GIS. If anybody is interested, you can join all GIS department students and others also. They can join. For details, you can contact our staff members, Yogesh Kutre sir or Suraj Mense sir or myself. If
sir, can I ask a question?
Yeah, please.
Sir, does GIS and remote sensing has any difference on mapping on land or using them on land and on and in a scenario of underwater mapping under the water, like the submerged land for petrology and for other mining aspects?
Yeah, I already told optical remote sensing is not possible. Such kind of scanning, especially the subsurface scanning, is not possible to the optical remote sensing. But like some laser scanning, and which I shown here the GP, so the penetration is needed in the underground or under surface, and that is why some advanced remote sensing tools can be helped for such types of we can say that the remote sensing. But the optical remote sensing or regular remote sensing, which is routinely carrying out with the help of electromagnetic radiations, has a limitations to go in the deep surface and especially in the underground. But some advanced remote sensing, which I was showing some slide, which
like
has
LIDAR.
A potential to map in subsurface.
Like LIDAR.
Yeah, LIDAR, sir. Yeah. LIDAR.
So does it give the same potential result as it gives on land or on surface?
Exactly. Exactly, because it's map accurately the things which is in the subsurface and underground.
So what kind of problems or what kind of problems do scientists or geomapping team face when they map underwater?
Actually, I'm not an expert, but some mathematical analysis of oceans and some subsurface knowledge like metal and non-metallic things, which is mapped with this remote sensing, and then they can go for the further application. But accuracy might be an issue. I already told I'm not expert with this, but accuracy might be happen because as we know that the roughness, rigidness, water is more easier as compared to the subsurface to penetrate the upcoming this radiations, and that is why it has some what we can say easier as compared to the subsurface. And the barrier is that we cannot go more deep again. Just a possible in a some feet,
shallow
in some meter. Not possible in deep.
Yeah. Maybe Thank tidal you, fluctuations. Maybe tidal yeah. fluctuations can obstruct like high tide, low tide
yes,
for
sir.
Oceanic surveys.
Yes.
Yeah, any other questions?
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Sir, can we do a dissertation in this field?
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. Because this topic is clearly linked with the environment. Environmental sustainability is the need of time. And I cannot say you can go only dissertation. You can go for the career also in this because a great potential. Nowadays, people clearly understand how our environment is important for the better futures. So I can say you just not go for the dissertation. You go for your degree. Just sir is announced here. You go for the courses, and then you go for the such kind of job supports. So it has a great future.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Even you can go for consultation.
Definitely.
Your own consultancy can start.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
Anyone else?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, can net zero mining is possible?
Yeah.
And sir, what is the contribution of mining in pollution? Is mining cause very much pollution as compared to other sources of pollution?
Mining is responsible at some context for pollution. Like I was shown in a previous slide in the Ashoka coal mine, how it's producing some smoke, and mining is disturbing the environment. Mining responsible for forest cutting. Mining disturbing the habitat suitability of the wildlife, some sensitive species, and mining disturbing the ecological balance. So, but we cannot say that control the mine. Whatever resources we need in our daily life, these resources need to extract through mine. So mine is absolutely necessary, but we cannot, but we can make a balance in mining and environment. And that is why these types of technology need to integrate to understand. So I think mining has a problems, but if you go with the sustainable view, I think it's essential.
We require mineral resources also for development of the country. We need to go for mining, and mining definitely is helpful for mankind.
Yes,
unless we go for sustainable mining.
Sir, that sustainable mining is possible overall.
If
everybody come together, definitely it's possible, because one single decision making policy maker cannot do everything. Everybody from the root level to the decision maker need to integrate, need to work combinedly, and then this kind of sustainable development is really possible. And as we know that this is the global agenda, this is not the agenda only myself, just all peoples, it's the global agenda. So we have a future for this sustainable development. Definitely we need to go with this way.
Sir, can that sustainable mining be a research topic? Can we do research?
Absolutely. I'm again saying that it's a real topic, and we can go with this topic definitely.
Yeah.
Because I personally work on the Run-up Dam Diversion in Western Ghat. So many papers I finished work in my PhD. But I think I'm not started the, I cannot complete the entire work. It has a It has a work not for one generation, it has a work for the multiple generations. So it has a great future. Definitely can go.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Can you all open your videos? I'll take a snapshot. Open all your videos. Let me take a quick screenshot. Hi, Praveen is also there. Welcome,
yeah,
welcome.
I'm very, nice to meet you, sir.
Welcome. Dr. Gudur, welcome.
To the other participant, I would like to thank Praveen sir. Are my real hero here, I can say here, because I'm working with these peoples and I'm learning so many things from this kind of peoples. Really, industry, really supportive peoples. So, thank you, Anamgond sir and Praveen sir.
Thank you,
sir. Hi.
Thank you, thank you.
Thank you.
Now, I request our colleague Yogesh Kutre to present word of thanks.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to thank today's speaker, Dr. Sainath Ahir, and his wonderful lecture. He has delivered the lecture in a very much simplified manner. And I would like to thank sir for sparing his time on this occasion. I would like to thank the audience for showing their presence throughout the session. I also thank the organizers, Mining Engineers Association of India, President Shri Sanjay Patnaik sir, Chairman of Yummy AI Belgaum Chapter, Shri S.R. Hegde sir, Secretary Dr. P.T. Hanuman sir, and all the members of Yummy AI. I also thank Department of Geology, GSS College, and S.G. Balikundri Institute of Technology, Belgaum, for their association. Thank you once again. Thank you one and all. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you. Thank you, Ogesh. And it was a great occasion on Indian Mining Day. Thank you once again, each one of you.
Thank you, sir.
We'll be meeting.